So now quickly discuss what is the result we are going to get for this. So we are going to state this for a particular case. So let gamma is equals to 0 and okay. So notice that like we are setting this gamma to be 0 in this statement. So when we have this gamma equals to 0, so we are just going to call this exp4, but when and the case when gamma is greater than 0, case when we are this algorithm we are going to call exp4ix, okay, when gamma is greater than 0. But the result we have stated here for the case gamma equals to 0. And you can work out that for gamma greater than 0 also similar bound holds, okay. So now let us revisit this theorem. What we are saying, take gamma equals to 0 and you set your eta to be in this fashion and then assume that experts are deterministic, okay. What I mean by deterministic here is, yes, experts are actually giving me a probability vector, but it is going to be the same every time I give a particular context, okay. And we are also assuming that these experts are oblivious. What does that mean? So that whatever, based on whatever the rewards they are going to get, right, they are not going to change their distribution accordingly. So you, in a way you can, so this means like you can assume that each expert has already come up with what is the distribution he is going to put on each the arms for each context, and he is not going to change with what is the reward he has been observing so far. So that is his what is the context he observes, that is irrelevant to him. You just tell me what is the context and he will just tell you what is the distribution. In that case, then the regret we are going to get is under root of 2tk log m. So this looks very similar to what we had gotten for exp3, right, except the fact that this is now m instead of k. So the regret bound you have exp3 was 2tk log k, right, where k is the number, but now that k has become m now, where m corresponds to the number of experts, okay. So the proof we are going to skip, mean, I'm just there is one lemma which you need to get to prove this. I'm just going to state this lemma. Even that proof you can work out. It says that for all. Okay, so this is a lemma proof based on the it says that for any m the t equals to 1 to t Lexman t tilde t m minus I should write it this way. So what this lemma saying is, so what is this term giving you here? So let's take an M, an expert. What is this term giving you here? Right. So if you look into this XT tilde, right, what it basically give? The expected estimated rewards for that expert M, right? So in that way we can treat it as the total reward that has been obtained by expert M. Okay, and then we are comparing it against what is this quantity over here. So what is Q to N? Yeah, this is the probability with which I am going to choose expert N in round T. And what is this sum is going to then give? The expected rewards that I would have got from the experts. Okay, so it is basically going to say how is the reward gotten from one expert compares with the mean that would have got from all the experts, and it is going to bound, and eventually this this theorem uses this fact to bound it. So just to look into the book like how to get this. So and using all these things, finally we are going to get this as upper bound. Okay, so we will just skip it. Most of the proofs are very similar to what is there in exp 3 again. Okay, the ideas are all similar except for the fact that now we have to take into account two level of randomization into account, one with respect to the experts selection and another with respect to the arm selection. Okay, so now let's discuss couple of special cases. Earlier when we started this was by saying that I am going to take my fee to be fee could be all mapping from C to K. Yeah.
But
Yeah, so that standard assumption we make that the rewards are in the interval 0, 1. This x t vector, right, or x t I is in 0, 1. Okay. Suppose this C is finite. I mean, the cardinality of C is finite. And there are k arms. What will be the cardinality of this set phi? What is it? K to the power? So it is going to be k to the power cardinality of C, right? So in this case, if I took a particular phi, it is going to assign one value in k to each context, right? So in terms of, if I am going to think that as a probability vector, it looks like a unit vector, right? Where for that particular arm it is going to be 1, for others it is going to be 0. You got this point? So if I take a particular map here, it is going to assign a unique value to each value, each context here, but I can think that assignment as a probability vector. As how? I can assume that E M I is equals to, so let us say I am going to index this all the features, let us call them M 1 all the up to k to the power C. Okay. Then I am going to think that EMI in round T is nothing but indicator phi of whatever. Let us say this okay, so what I want to write here is, let us call my functions here as, let them enumerate, let them call this f1, phi1, phi2, phi3 all the way up to phi to the power phi k to the power c. Okay, I have these many maps. Then can I map it, the value recommended by expert M, or the value recommended, if I am going to treat it as a map, is nothing but this, right? So okay, so let us say each of these experts, there are k to the power cardinality of C experts, and I am going to treat them, these experts are nothing but these functions. Okay, so now experts are nothing but these functions. So what are going to they going to if I am going to give a particular context, what they are going to return me? It is, they are going to return me the arm that should be selected according to that phi in that round, right? Or based on that. But in terms of the probability vector, I can write like this, right? For the mth expert, I can just write it as like this probability vector. So this is just going to put value 1 on whatever the value this function assigned to that context T, and everywhere it is going to put to 0, right? So in that way, I can treat all the maps here as one different experts, and we are already in this setup, right, where I am going to set my ET function EMI to be exactly like this based on what is the map I am going to use in that round. So now then, even if I have a if I am going to define my regret in terms of these policies, all possible phi, is this regret bound still applies? it should apply, right? It is just like the experts are nothing but these maps here, and they are also, even though they are not giving distributions, that I can treat that as a distribution. Now, if I am going to apply this bound on this, what is that I am going to get? Yeah, so in that case, I am going to replace m by, so in that case, what is this? Yeah. Okay, but what is this regret bound? Like, we had gotten this regret bound by other method also, right? What was that method? Yeah, by applying exp3 for each of the context. If I maintain my exp3 for each of this context, I would have obtained this. Then what is big deal about this algorithm? Then why this is of any interest? Okay, yes, yeah, so this so when if I have to write this bound, it depends on the cardinality of C. When I applied all this algorithm, when I was in this setup, I only cared about the number of experts. I didn't care about how many possible contexts are there. Whatever the context I have, I'm just going to give it to an expert, and that expert is going to give me a distribution on my arms, right? So, this bound only worries about how many experts are there. I don't care about how many contexts are there. As long as I have finitely many experts, this bound works, right? And often I may not, as I said, often we will not be working with all the possible maps. We will be working with a restricted set of experts, as I said, like that, as I discussed in the beginning of the class, that restricted class could be based on the partition or similarity, or you are going to just only fix the number of phis to be finite, like phi 1, phi 2, up to phi m. So in that case, there you have only finitely many m, and irrespective of how many contexts you are going to deal with, this bound is valid. Fine.
So yeah.
Even
in this, we would require the number of contexts. That's how we have gotten the.
Yeah, so number of contexts is finite. Yeah, this number of contexts is finite. Yes, but it could be arbitrarily large, right? Which I don't worry about here.
Capital M is equal to that.
Yes, when you are going to deal with all possible maps.
Okay. Right.
I am just giving you the worst case when you are going to deal with all of them. Because see, when I worked out with maintaining one context, EXP algorithm for each context, right? I didn't care about how many policies I will be competing against. It was just like maintaining one exp3 for each one of them, and that blindly, that gave me this bound.
Yes.
But here I'm deriving it based on how many experts I'm going to deal with.
You will take it to be a much smaller set than
you. Yes, I can take, but the number of contexts could be same here still. Here though, this experts, I have only m experts here, but the number of contexts I'm going to deal with could be same as this case also.
Right.
So in this case, you see that I got log n, but here it could be cardinality C into log k. It could be much, much larger. if the number of contacts is very large. Okay, so with this we will conclude this discussion on adversarial contextual bandits. We will not go into the lower bound proof and for this. As you see, do you expect this bound to be optimal? You expect it to be simply square root tk, or m should come into picture? M should be there, or at least order wise, you feel okay. Square root t, we know that we can't do better than that. Fine. Maybe like k also, I can't get rid of, because from the adversarial setting, I also know that it is like square root tk, right? So for us now, the new term that has popped up is log m. Is that log m is the best, or we can do better? I also don't know. Maybe
similar in some sense to the weighted majority case.
Yeah.
So in that there is that log d term is there. Log m is somewhat similar to that log d term, where d is the number of experts in it.
Yeah, but we don't know. Weighted majority is the best. I mean, whatever the bound we got, that is the best we could get. That is full information, whatever it is. Yeah.
That is there in
exp. Yeah, k won't be there because it's a full information case. We are dealing with the bandit case here, right? So k will come into picture definitely, because we are having only 1kth of information compared to the full information case here.